Thank you for joining us today at New Directions for Women, a program of the Morris County Chapter of the National Organization for Women. My name is Rebecca Lubetkin, and I and our entire crew are volunteers and members of this chapter of NOW. And we've been at this a long time. We're currently starting our 21st year. All of our shows are archived at the Sophia Smith Collection at Smith College, and are also available on YouTube at www.youtube.com/mcnownj. The title of today's show, Divorce, The Facts About Alimony and Equitable Distribution, is the first of two shows about divorce. The second show will cover child custody and child support. Today we'll hear about changes in state laws and guidelines, but it's important to remember that these laws differ from state to state. So today we will be discussing New Jersey law. And here to tell us what is new is one of New Jersey's outstanding matrimonial lawyers, Salvatore Simeone. Mr. Simeone, and I'm going to call you Sal if
that's
it's
fine.
Okay, has achieved the New Jersey Super Lawyers designation in multiple years as one of the state's top 100 attorneys. A graduate of Rutgers and of Seton Hall School of Law, he has practiced family law, certified by the New Jersey Supreme Court, for more than 20 years. During that time, he has also provided services without fee to the Jersey Battered Women's Shelter and the Women's Center of the County College of Morris. Welcome, Sal.
Thank you, Rebecca.
We have so many questions that I'm going to jump in, but I do want to start with asking you a little about your journey into family law and whether this is something that you planned on at an early age.
Well, I can't say that I planned on it, absolutely not. I went through high school, I graduated in 1978. I had one little quick stop in Montclair State, and then I wasn't in college again until 1985. Where I then began my journey at night and working as a letter working as a letter carrier for the United States Post Office.
Wow.
So from 1985, I began going to night school, ultimately graduating from Rutgers at night. Then I went on to law school, ultimately graduating from Seton Hall Law at night. And through that whole time, I was a letter carrier in Morristown, New Jersey, delivering the mail, ultimately ending up owning a law firm with Cutler and Simeone.
I thought you were going to say owning a post office.
No, owning the law firm of the man who was the first stop on the route. Larry Cutler's office was the first stop on the route for many of those years. And ultimately, he and I got together and were partners for many years, and I was a co-owner of a firm with him that he had founded years before. And so to say that it was planned, no, it was not planned. That my grandfather was a lawyer and my cousin Robert is a lawyer, but that really wasn't the influence that made me do it. What made me do it was working in the post office for 12 years and knowing that I had to get out and get a better income for my family and my children and move along that way.
That could do it.
And that did it. It was a good motivator.
Great. So let's just start, before we talk about alimony and equitable distribution, just some basic facts about divorce. If both parties agree that they don't want to be married, what do they have to do?
Well, even if you both agree, you still have to file for divorce at the county courthouse of where you live. One party files a complaint for divorce. The other party can either file a counterclaim, they can file a one-sheet appearance, or you don't even have to file, and the other party can go forward in a default situation. But usually, one party files, and the other one, if it's an agreed-upon situation, may just file an appearance, and the parties will go forward that way.
So you do have to file. How long will it take from the time that you file?
Well, if it's an amicable situation, it could be very quick. But generally, even when people tell you, well, everything's agreed upon, the famous last words, and next thing you know, a year and a half later, you're still litigation.
Uh-huh.
So it's hard to say how long it will take, but if people are absolutely in agreement and come to you with a signed property settlement agreement, it could be as short as a month. But that's with a signed property settlement agreement.
Yeah.
If not, even the smallest disagreements can sometimes bubble up into many months of litigation.
There's so much beyond them both wanting the divorce, there are so many other things that they have to agree.
And once they find out what they actually have to talk about, things they really didn't think about, suddenly they're like, well, wait a minute, we didn't talk about that. Or yeah. I have to get life insurance for $2 million or yeah. things of that, like more of the smaller issues, which they really didn't think about. Suddenly you bring them to them and they're like, well, we didn't talk about that. Mm-hmm. And there it goes.
Then you go again. But what if only one party wants a divorce and the other doesn't? What do they have to show?
In New Jersey, the other party can't stop you from getting a divorce. It is a no-fault state. So you can file under irreconcilable differences or the grounds of separation, which they're no-fault grounds. And in New Jersey...
How long is the separation?
Well, you have to be separated for 18 months before you can file. And the separation is a true separation. You cannot live in the same house. You can't say, I'm going to live on the first floor and she lives on the second floor or in separate bedrooms. Can't do that. It is a true separation.
That makes it hard on the budget.
It's very hard. And then there's also now, since Christy Whitman many years ago put in irreconcilable differences. And that is a six-month waiting period, which is oftentimes already done when people come to you. They've told you that the marriage is broken many months before, even years before. So you can go right ahead and begin your divorce process. And there's no name-calling needed. It's simply marriage is over, and parties now move forward in that.
Even if one really wants to stay married,
They cannot stop it.
Okay. So let's talk about alimony now. First of all, what is alimony and what's its objective?
Well, alimony is often called spousal support in the court, but lay people refer to it as alimony usually. And it's simply a way that the payor, which is 95% of the time the husband, is providing the wife with money on a monthly basis for a term of years or in past it's permanent time, but which is no longer due to the new laws. And the money that he's providing to her is usually along with child support if the parties had children and the wife has custody, which again is, and tonight I'll talk in terms of the husband paying alimony and the wife with the children, because that's just generally the situation. There are times it's flipped and, right. you know, maybe half-time custody, but for the topic to talk about it, let's assume the husband's paying alimony, and it's to give the wife money so that she could live in a reasonably comparable standard that she had enjoyed during the marriage. Now, the new alimony law talks about that both parties have to be able to live at a reasonably comparable standard that they enjoyed during the marriage, and that neither one should have the advantage.
Everybody knows that's crazy, because if they've lived together in one household,
you can't support two houses the way you could support one.
Right.
And that is an absolute truism. However, I think the new law is striving to, at least from the point of view of the fathers or the husbands, at least let me be able to live as well as her at a comparable standard and don't give her more of the money than gives to the husband. And many times the attorneys involved and the mediators involved strive to reach a fair compromise between both parties. So I don't necessarily know if that new part of the law was necessary, because when you do settle a case, you try to make sure that both parties have a fair deal and move forward, you know, in their life able to live at a reasonably comparable standard, not the way they were when one income dealt with everybody. Now one income has to carry two houses, and it's not that easy, but we do find a way to split them up and get the money separated.
Mm-hmm. But it is dependent upon the income of the person. I mean, it has nothing to do with what level you want to live on. It has to do with the income of
exactly.
the person who's paying.
Exactly.
And that may be very limited.
Sometimes there's not enough money to pay for two houses. Sometimes you have a party getting divorced where there's $70,000, and now all of a sudden there's two houses and there's three children that have to be supported, and the payor, the husband's making $70,000 gross, and the mom has been a stay-at-home mom, and now that $70,000 has to be split up to carry both households. Of course, the court looks to the mother to now get a job and to try to contribute to the money. But sometimes in a situation, they may get divorced after 20, 25 years of marriage, and the mom just doesn't have the skills any longer. She may be in her late 50s, early 50s, and it's very difficult to get out and make a job, make money earning more than $20,000, $25,000.
Limited education, too.
Limited education. All those factors are what alimony tries to replace. Because she gave up her career, her possible career, to stay home and take care of the kids. It allowed him to go out, enhance his career, maybe become an attorney, become a doctor, whatever he did. And therefore, that's what the alimony actually tries to compensate for.
Are the wrongful actions of either party considered in determining alimony?
Even though there is, in the statute, a little 1% that says fault can be considered, It is in New Jersey, 99% of the cases when it comes to alimony, fault is not a consideration. So if somebody comes to you and says, look, my husband was cheating on me or my wife was cheating on me, we tell the clients, it doesn't make a difference. Do not waste time. I mean, other than emotionally, you have to get past that. When it comes to the actual financial deal of the case, you do not get any money, more money or any less money because of someone who cheated or even if someone committed domestic violence. In the actual divorce, you really don't get any extra money or any less money. There is something called the Tevis count, which we could talk about another show, where if there's a personal injury inflicted upon a spouse in the marriage, the person who was injured could sue the spouse in the marriage for a personal injury. And that's sometimes in the form of money or property, you know, if it's actually succeeded. But leaving that aside, you don't get any extra alimony or less alimony, even for if there's domestic violence involved.
Then how is the alimony determined?
The alimony is determined on various factors. There's 13 factors, and with the new law, some of the factors have changed, supposedly changed. Actually, though, if you read the statute, many of the factors are still there. Alimony is determined by the age of the parties, how old they are, and there's also a relationship with equitable distribution, the assets and the liabilities parties have. But I would say generally the age of the parties, the length of the marriage, and how much money parties make, I would say those are the three major factors when you're doing that. And for instance, if the husband's making $150,000 and the wife is home and not working, there's something called imputed income. And the court will, or attorneys, if they're settling the case, the attorneys will agree upon what do we think the wife could make if she went out and got a job now. That's called imputed income. If we can't agree on that, sometimes a vocational expert comes in. The wife's interviewed by the vocational expert, and they'll come up with a recommendation as to what they think she can make and in what area she can work. Many times that's argued about as well. But imputed income is a way to place an income on the mother. The husband has his income, what he's making, so they take what he's making, what the wife is making or could make through imputed income. And that difference of income is really how they take that and they try to come up with a calculation to then say alimony should be X per month or annually, and then we get to the term of years and how long the alimony is going to be. That the term of years is predominantly decided how long you're married. It also talks about the children and the ages of the children. So alimony could be short, limited duration alimony. It could be 2, 3, 4, 5 years. There used to be permanent alimony, which meant forever, truly forever. Mm-hmm. If the husband was working, forever. Now it's been changed. Permanent label has been taken out of the statute, and in place of it, the law says that on a marriage of less than 20 years, a person, mostly women, could get alimony to the length of the marriage. So if you're married 18 years or 19 years, which normally would have really been a permanent alimony case, now you can't get permanent alimony, but you could get alimony 18 or 19 years, depending on the length of the marriage. So while permanent alimony has changed the law somewhat, getting alimony for 18 or 19 years, if you're 45 or 48 years old, still gets you into your middle to late 60s. So the change, and while it's there and some people were happy about it, I still think there's ample room to give the mothers and the women and the wives in the world substantial and adequate alimony. There's also something called open durational alimony in place of permanent. And that means if it's a long-term marriage, over 20 years, and the situation exists where the statute calls it exceptional circumstances. In those exceptional circumstances, if you read them, they're actually very much like the circumstances in the actual statute that was before. So things like, did she give up her career? Did she get a different proportion of, or did somebody get a different proportion of the equitable distribution? Those are reasons why you could get open durational alimony, which could be longer than the 20 years. Now, I think the judges are probably going to shy away from that open durational, because the whole idea was to not have permanent anymore.
Right.
But it's there, and if you're a woman and you feel you deserve that, and your attorney advises you can qualify for that, then it's there for you to try for.
You know what I don't understand? What I've never understood: if a woman gives up employment, possibly her education as well as her opportunities for employment, to raise children, she's been working without pay for all of those years. Now, if alimony is to help her to live after the marriage, mm-hmm. what is to compensate her for all of those years of giving herself to the family without any compensation?
Well, that is really what alimony is. The non-financial.
No, I mean, if you say, well, the alimony is paying for your past labors.
And that non-financial contribution is then the labor. Her labor as being a mom, staying home, raising the kids, and giving up her career is really the main reason that spousal support exists. Because she could not make herself earn the dollars that she needs today to live. So the husband has to compensate her for that.
But there's also the fact that beyond child support.
I'm not talking about child support.
No, I know. Beyond child support, now she's divorced. She has to supply the house, the electric, the lighting,
all of that,
which isn't directly related to the children.
No, but it is related to the alimony. Let me explain.
And that small amount of alimony that she may be getting because her husband doesn't make a great salary can't in any way compensate her for her past labors. Forget about her present labors.
Well, I believe that's why the standard talks about a reasonably comparable standard of the marriage. Because alimony is not there to allow you to live greater than you lived during the marriage.
And you never do.
Correct. Yeah. But there are times when alimony is substantial, and it's not in a case where there's $60,000 and a lady who hasn't worked. But it could be a gentleman who made $300,000 or $400,000.
Right.
So then there's a larger amount of money. But even in the cases where it's $80,000 the gentleman's making, the wife is staying home with the children, a calculation that's often used is take the difference in the incomes, $80,000 for him. Let's say the imputation is $20,000 for the mom who stayed at home, a $60,000 difference. And the mom would get a third of the difference in a long-term marriage. So 80 minus 20 is 60, a third of that, that's what she would get, $20,000 in alimony. Divide that by 12, how much per that is that per month? Now, another problem for moms with alimony is that it's taxable. So whatever you get in alimony, you absolutely have to remember that if you don't have a lot of tax deductions, you have to put some money aside each month to take away from the alimony you're receiving. And it is, you know, it definitely cuts into what
she's getting. Is it ever given in a lump sum rather than periodic?
It is, but many times the person who's paying the alimony doesn't have the income or the asset base to make the lump sum payment. Because if it's a 10 or a 15 year alimony, and even if it's $50,000 a year, if you do that times 10, it's $500,000, and there are some considerations to lower it, like taxability, present valuing the money, but it still will come out to $250,000, $300,000, and many times there's just not the assets to give her that in a lump sum.
Right.
There's also considerations why men will not pay in a lump sum, because the judge can't order a lump sum. The judge can only order a term and a monthly payment. And the gentleman sometimes will not do a lump sum because they feel she may get married, and then the alimony would stop. She may live with somebody and the alimony may stop.
They can't predict what.
So what they do is they try to protect themselves. Now, many ladies try to get a lump sum for various reasons, including it gives them some freedom. They can possibly get married and maybe they can live with somebody. So the issue of cohabitation is a hot issue in alimony issues. And now the law has changed in one regard with cohabitation. In the past, you couldn't cohabitate with somebody or you couldn't live with somebody akin to a marriage, like it was a relationship like a marriage. In other words, even if it wasn't living together 7 days a week, if you were living with somebody, let's say more than half the week, and you were, you know, he had the garage code, he was cutting the lawn, doing the gutters, it was clearly you're living like a couple. You still had to prove as the father to try to cut alimony that they were commingling the funds. So that made it a two-step process. The new statute has taken out the commingling of funds area and just if you can prove the cohabitation. So again, it's a small change because quite frankly, if you are cohabitating with someone,
you're probably
commingling funds. And many times in cases I've been in, when once we've proven cohabitation one way or the other, whether I'm on the mom or the dad side, the case usually settles because to go through that whole commingling analysis is sort of a waste of money because it's very difficult to separate your money and keep it separated.
So, in light of this, are prenuptials a good idea?
Well, prenuptials, from the point of view of the person who has the assets, are a good idea. But if you're the person without the assets, they're certainly not a good idea. And it's a very, very sensitive topic to try to come to your spouse 30 days before the marriage and say, here, I want you to sign this and give away the store. I mean, there are situations where we have people enter into them or people try to break them as they're not enforceable. So I will say to you this, I don't know if it's a good idea.
They're not enforceable?
Sometimes they're not enforceable. Oh. And one way to ensure that a prenuptial is enforceable is to give the agreement to your spouse ahead of time, like at least 30 days ahead of time. Make sure there's drafts that go between the two of you so that if there's any changes, you have a record of the changes. But I would say the key ingredient is to make sure your spouse has an attorney and that the assets and liabilities of each party have to be on a separate sheet of paper, Schedule A and Schedule B, and attached to the agreement. And in that schedule of list of assets and liabilities, there needs to be a very specific amount put down for those assets and the income of each party. If you leave a range on that, my business is worth $200,000 to $2 million. How does she know what she's giving away? It could be 200, it could be 2 million. So again, listing of assets and liabilities, very, very important. Having both spouses with separate attorneys, very important. And giving the other party a long enough time to look at it, bring it to an attorney, digest it.
And decide whether they want to get married under the circumstances.
Very difficult. I've had a couple of cases where the marriage was called off, at least temporarily, and then ultimately got put back together without the prenup. And I've had some times where it was called off, put back together, ultimately with the prenup.
What about equitable distribution? What is it?
It's not equal distribution. And many people make the mistake of thinking it's equal. It's equitable, which really means fair. Now, the statute does talk about starting from a 50-50 standpoint. And by and large, it is a 50-50 division. However, there are times when it would not be. For instance, if a woman was supposed to get alimony and her husband had recently lost his job and didn't get a new one yet, so she was not able to get the alimony to the level she would have, it's very possible a judge may say, well, I'm going to give her 65% of the proceeds from the sale of the house. In this way, it compensates a little bit for what she should have had things been the same, except for this recent turn of events. So that's an example of when ED, or equitable distribution, would not be 50-50. But by and large, it's 50% to her, 50% to him. But gifts are outside of the marriage. Gifts are not split. Inheritances are not split unless you put both names on it. So if you get an inheritance, you have to keep it in your name, solely in your name. Don't use that money for anything of the marriage, and then it cannot be split. Gifts, the same thing. Premarital money, of course, or premarital property, that's also out of the marital estate. The marital estate runs from the date of marriage to the date of the filing the complaint for divorce. That snapshot is what is involved. I often tell people, if you hit the lottery the day before you file the complaint for divorce, it's in the pot. But if you hit it the day after you file the complaint for divorce, it's not in the pot. Now, it could get a little complicated if you bought the ticket in the marriage and the drawing was after the marriage. But again, there's always, with divorce law, and I guess law in general, there's usually exceptions to the rule and ways that people really tend to look at things a little differently.
Well, what did they do before equitable distribution?
Well, all of the divorce laws were amended in the early 70s. And prior to that, things were really sort of, I don't want to call it a black hole, but things were very different than they are today, and women's rights were much less than they are today. I know that men sometimes say the laws are set up for women, and women sometimes say the laws are set up for men, but in reality, the laws that are there on the books today, in my opinion, after doing this for 20 years, and by the way, I've only been certified 15, not 20, the laws that I see today, I think are very fair for both parties. Mm-hmm. And I really don't agree with people when they tell me it's set up for one side or the other. It just so happens my practice has sort of grown, and I represent many more women than men, maybe 80% of women at this point. I really don't have a reason for that, but it really just has.
Well, here's an example. If someone has a small business and it can't be divided, and say it's a one-person business, so it's dependent upon the spouse, how is its value considered in determining the amount of equitable distribution?
Well, all businesses, when they're valued, are generally done by hiring a forensic accountant. Many times you hear the gentleman say, I'm the person who runs the business. Without me, the business has no value. And that's what they try to use as the reason that the woman gets no part of it. That doesn't work. It's a tried and true method by the gentleman. It never works and never will work. Simply because it's a one-person business does not mean there's not a value. There's your goodwill. What you've built up in that business. Sal Simeone's law firm. I could be a one-person law firm. There's goodwill with my name. People come to me because of my name.
Right.
It does not matter, or if a firm is more of an institutional firm, two or three gentlemen, there's a value to that. And the forensic accountants have three methods they can value the firm in or any business in.
They both choose this forensic accountant?
The judges usually say, let's pick a mutual one that nobody has any bias with. Sometimes people insist on getting their own, and then the other side gets their own. And now you have two competing experts, and if the case goes to trial, the judge will oftentimes hire a third, which would be sort of the court expert. So it can get to be quite a show when you get the forensic experts.
And expensive, too.
And very, very expensive. But I will say this. I believe the forensic experts are unnecessary in this case. And many of the forensic experts, at least some of the gentlemen I use, are instrumental in settling cases. They get everybody together in a room. They talk finances. And they really get things done. And you know,
sort of like mediators.
Very much so. Yeah. I use many forensic accountants, but a few firms in general, which we think are the better ones, and they'll sit in a room afterwards in the settlement with everyone and really work the deal. And they know the numbers, they crunch the numbers, and the lawyers and the accountants get together and they generally come up with a deal. We call that a five or a six way, when the parties get together with their lawyers and the accountants. We call that a five or a six way meeting.
This time is going fast.
Yeah.
And I have a question, though, that doesn't relate to equitable distribution, but it's something that I'm curious about. In some states, once marriage equality was passed, they got rid of civil unions and even domestic partnerships. Mm-hmm. Does New Jersey allow civil unions and domestic partnerships continue, even though we now have marriage equality?
Well, again, that's a topic for another show. It's a very detailed and
complicated
topic.
I'm curious.
New Jersey has civil unions for sure.
Still?
Yes. And if we want to do a show on that, we better set up an hour or two.
Okay.
Because it's complicated. We'd have to go through the whole law. But absolutely. New Jersey is at the forefront of divorce laws, not the back end. I would say California is very progressive, but New Jersey is very progressive in their divorce laws and trying to protect both parties and, of course, the children, which really are the most important part of any case, any divorce, the children. My subspecialty in divorce is custody, and I do a lot of custody work, which some people don't want to do because it's very emotional and very heavy. But to me, it's where you can make the most difference. Money is money. It's fungible. It can be distributed. It can be divided. To divide a family, to set one person as the sole custody or the physical custody person and the other one as the parent who visits, is a very difficult situation. And, of course, you bring psychological experts into it, and we'll talk about it at our next show. And that is another very complicated part of divorce. People think it's easy to get divorced. It is not. It's a difficult process.
With children.
Or without children. With children, it's very difficult. It's also difficult without children. And make sure you pick the right attorney. Try to find somebody who's usually in your county, unless they have a statewide reputation. Certified attorney is very good because they've gone through the licensing procedure.
Certified by the Supreme Court.
By the Supreme Court.
As a matrimonial
Correct.
Attorney.
And also, there's no substitute for experience. You know, a young attorney is often very passionate and very aggressive, but you need to have that and experience. You have to have both. And I think that if you can't find a good attorney, go to your county bar association. They often give good referrals, things like that.
And your website is?
I'm at www.weiner. The website is www.weinerlesniak.com. That's in Parsippany, New Jersey. We have a full-service firm, not just matrimonial, so I can actually meet the needs of people by sending them to other attorneys in my office.
Well, this has been very, very interesting. Stay tuned. We're going to have another show on child custody and child support.
And one thing I'd like to say, with all the news about domestic violence, with these people going on, that's another whole
maybe
topic.
Maybe we should have a new one.
And that's something we do as well in my firm, and I do that, and my partner, Joe Frieda, does that. We handle many domestic violence cases.